ein gutes Ergebnis, also keine gute Ausgangslage. Aber wir haben an uns geglaubt, wir hatten auch Verletzungen und mussten das kompensieren. Und da sieht man, was für eine Mannschaft wir haben.
This video has been brought to you by GoFiber. Enter your pictures and win a 1-year supply of GoFiber. It's easy to enter. Order a free sample, take a clear before and after pictures and send them to selfie@gofiber.com. Hey, this is Matt and welcome back to the channel, everybody, where I'm going to be sharing with you a short analysis of Jordan Shaqiri's hair transplant he decided to do in mid-2019. And although I have already received many requests from you guys to do a hair transplant analysis video on Jordan, I decided to wait with it since I didn't feel like there was enough good before and after, or especially after photos of him after his hair transplants, or videos online. I wasn't really able to find any good ones until like 3 weeks ago when I discovered this video here, which I'm gonna be discussing here. Now, before I start with analyzing his hair transplant result, like how many grafts he got, was it FUE or FUT, was he a good hair transplant candidate or not, what is his hair type, hair quality, and stuff like that, let me briefly start with his hair loss story. Around the age of 20, 21, 22, basically his early 20s, we can already see some first signs of hair loss, especially looking at the profile. It's pretty much obvious on the corners. This is an interesting hair loss progression, in my opinion, when somebody goes from like Norwood 1 to Norwood 3, as we will see in Shaqiri's case, because his frontal tuft, especially the mid-frontal point, stays pretty damn thick and dense, and he's not gonna move, he's not gonna recede over the course of the next coming years, as you will see, as much as his corners will do. He starts receding on his corners almost just backwards, leaving him with this really thick and dense looking frontal tuft and pretty well preserved mid frontal point, which is going to be there. And we can see it here based on like how small his forehead still looks, despite having like really, really like pronounced hair loss recession on his corners, okay? So he started losing his hair with 21, 22. I don't think he has been using any medication. Maybe it's very hard to tell whether he has been already on medication from the age 22, 23. I have no idea. We can see this guy ending up pretty much like a good Norwood 3 1 or 2 months prior to his hair transplant, and it was like in May 2019. And some people may argue maybe Norwood 4. I would say a good Norwood 3. Still, you see that the frontal, mid-frontal point, pretty well preserved. Maybe slightly recessed, but not that much. And the frontal tuft is also pretty thick. He gets the hair transplant in the mid-2019. And then he starts pretty much covering up and camouflaging his result all the way until like December 2019. So even after like 6 months, he let the hair from the sides here grow longer and just comb it forward to mask the transplanted areas, the recipient areas. So it's still very hard to tell like how the 6 month result kind of turned out, because again, I assume he got a hair transplant in July of 2019. This to me looks like maybe 3-4 months after his hair transplant, we can already see that there is a sign of new hairline being formed, and the hair starts growing. It's very uneven growth, which is very typical for the first three, especially the 3 to 5 months after the hair transplant. One side of your hairline can grow much thicker than the other. You know, that's totally normal, but again, between the 6 to 12 month mark, it should already start, you know, evening out, and after 12 months you should have more or less the same density on both corners, which will be also the case with him. You will see in a moment. I would definitely say it's an FUE. I'm gonna talk about the graft number in a moment, but again, I don't see any reason why he would get FUE, considering he was only like a just a good Norwood 3, nothing think more. No signs of diffuse hair loss. He doesn't have like afro hair or anything like that that could bring like additional complications when choosing FUE. For example, after looking at photos like this, if you would just base your opinion about his hairline from photos like these, you would say that it looks pretty pluggy. The grafts implanted on the hairline especially are very robust looking. Also, these hairs here in the temporal zone already, the transition from the hairline to the temple, it just didn't look that natural to me. And I was like, dude, I don't believe that this guy would have done this to him with his salary, with his, you know, public persona and, you know, kind of like celebrity, soccer celebrity status. I think he would have gone for the best of the best, you know. I stumbled upon this video, which had been posted on the 31st of October, like 3 weeks ago. And here, this is like a post match interview with him. And we can see, this is probably, I'm not sure if it's daylight or not, but we can see his hairline clearly right now. We can see the density, we can see the coverage, we can see the hairline, how it frames his face right now much, much better, and it's more natural looking. If we compare it to his Instagram photos of his hairline, it just doesn't look that pluggy anymore. It looks much softer, although I still see that the doctor tried to do the micro irregularities in the hairline in a slightly zigzaggy pattern, which is a bit predictable to me. I just see probably every one and a half centimeters, I see the same thing, the same zigzag type of thing. I don't know if you see that. Let me know in the comments below if you can relate to me in this. Every doctor that does hair transplants has his own strategy, how to do a hairline, how to do it naturally and dense enough so the patient will be happy as well. And you should always go to a doctor who not only is like skilled and experienced and does his job really good, treats your donor area well without over harvesting, but you also have to like his hairlines, period. Okay, there are good doctors that are praised on forums and anywhere online, but some guys just don't like their hairlines, they just don't like them. Okay, and that's why you have to also choose the doctor who fulfills the quality criteria on the technical side of the hair transplant, but he also has to, you know, create the hairline that you really like. It does look natural to me. I think he should be happy. The density is really good, and I'm gonna share with you why is it really good. It's simply because this guy, number one, has really good hair caliber, in my opinion. Really good one for a hair transplant. He has definitely thicker hair than myself. I'm like an average hair transplant candidate, and this guy has a thicker hair. His hair starts curling a little bit, as you can see here, after a certain length, after only like 4 or 5 centimeters already, it's visible. Mine hair is not like that, and that's why I think his hair is more suitable for a hair transplant in general. His donor area is also better than mine, in my opinion. It is above average, because usually also guys with slightly thicker hair caliber have also better looking, not better looking, but denser looking donor area. It means that they have more hair follicles per square centimeters on the donor, and thus more opportunities to extract. The final amount of grafts, in my opinion, is somewhere between 2,600 to 3,000 grafts. You cannot tell it precisely, of course. I haven't even seen like his immediate post-op photos of his recipient area, so that would have been much easier for me to tell. But I assume, based on his coverage here, density, I assume something from 2,500 to 3,000 grafts. Again, the higher his hair per graft average was, the more I think it was like 2,500. And if the hair per graft average actually wasn't that good as I think, then it was probably more close to 3,000 grafts. But since I think that his hair per graft average must have been like fairly good, I would say it was more like 2,500 grafts, 2,700 grafts, something like that. So yeah, like 1,300 one corner, 1,300 another corner, and also something at the front as well, because again, his hairline His mid-frontal point was very well preserved, pretty dense looking still, even at his age, his current age, which is like 29. I guess these were pretty much my thoughts on Jordan Shaqiri's hair transplant. And for all you guys who are interested in a hair transplant in 2020 or 2021, I have something really, really cool for you, because I just created an amazing hair transplant guide bundle, which you can benefit from no matter if you have already done a hair transplant and you are a hair transplant virgin, you are seriously considering a hair transplant, be it anywhere in the world or Turkey. There's also a one ebook that I have for you, which is specifically devoted to hair transplant in Turkey, and it's called The Ultimate Hair Transplant Guide in Turkey, where I basically list you all the important clinics or all the best clinics in Turkey that I have been able to stumble upon over the years researching clinics in Turkey and also helping out guys with their hair transplant research in Turkey, collecting a lot of feedback, spending thousands of hours online researching, talking to guys about their experiencing, browsing forums, browsing Facebook groups. And I kind of put this collection together about Turkish clinics and chose the best of the best clinics. Of course, there are some clinics where you are more likely to end up with a dense looking hairline with not over harvested donor area, and the clinics where doctor does most of the job. And these are the clinics, I call them, they're in the safe zone in Turkey, where you're real likely to get a good result and everything will go good. Then you have signs of the safety zone, where there are doctors who are performing their hair transplants, they're doing one patient per day, their experience, but sometimes, you know, the density is not as great as in the safe zone, and they're having great standards, great ethical, great ethics, and they do things really good, but the density sometimes is not as great. And then you have the package zone, where, funny enough, the density tends to be pretty good, but the clinics don't do it as natural always. There is a lot of the highest chance actually to end up with an over-harvested donor area and things like this. So it's very good to have a guide which only kind of chooses like the 3 or 5 best clinics in each zone and kind of tells you where to go and which clinics and doctors you should contact. And this is what the hair transplant in Turkey guide is all about, because I know that many of you guys are interested in a hair transplant in Turkey, so you may want to check this guide out. It's really cool, and I wish I had something like that before I started researching on Turkish clinics like 4 years ago. So you will definitely love this one. And you can also get the whole bundle with 3 other ebooks that I have for you. We have frequently asked questions, 99 frequently asked questions before your hair transplant. We have hair transplant research done simple and done right in 3 essential steps. And we have also a collection of best hair transplant clinics in 20 or hair transplant doctors in 24 countries worldwide, which you can also get as a whole bundle. So that's something that I have for you at the end, guys. Pretty much I'm sharing everything I know about hair transplants. I have learned based on interviewing doctors, researching, collecting precious information online and offline, all in this bundle. Okay, so that was my secret surprise at the end of this video, guys. So if you are interested in a hair transplant, I highly, highly, highly recommend you checking that out, and I will see you in another video.